glory. Amen. Could you, we want to find out where some of you, what kingdom you're from.
I am from Africa.
I am from Kenya.
I'm from America.
I'm from Jupiter.
Could you tell us where, what kingdom you're representing today?
London. I am from Nigeria.
New York.
New York.
New York.
African.
I'm from the Heavenly Kingdom.
I'm also from the Heavenly Kingdom.
Amen. And we're representing, I represent the kingdom of God.
Amen. Kingdom of heaven and Jerusalem.
Amen. Could you all take a bow? Amen. Hallelujah. Well, the kingdom of heaven, you, Pastor Adam, you're going, we have some treats that are going to be coming out next. And I did find the little, now, I don't know how to pronounce that. Monica knows the name for that. It's a little the Jewish, little Jewish type cookie or what have you. Amen. So, Pastor Adam, you come up. We're going to also, we're going to get some of the, now, I seen a particular type of king that was out there with a gold chain on. And I was like, okay, I was trying to. And I wanted to know what kingdom he was from with the representing the gold chain. And I don't know what happened. I think somebody might have robbed him out the hood because he don't have his key, he don't have his crown no more, his kid anymore. Could I get Deacon Harris, amen, and Deacon Dale, we're gonna use you as readers. We're gonna be coming from the book of Esther. So Pastor Adam, if you will join me up here, hallelujah. Glory be to God. And we're going to pray for those, and we're going to open up in prayer. If you can get a microphone, so you guys come on down. We're going to be in the book of Esther.
I was there.
We thank God for us being triumphant that we get to take a, where did we going to start? We'll let Pastor Adams start off. And now remember, those of you, when we read, when you hear the name Esther, we're going to say what? Woo! Woo! When we hear, and when we hear the name Haman, it is boo, thumbs down. Okay?
Mordecai.
Okay, amen. And Mordecai, yay! Two thumbs up for Mordecai. Thumbs down for Haman. Yep. Hallelujah. So let me open up in prayer. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you for this day. We bind the works of Satan in the name of Jesus, Father. We know that this also represents Spy Wednesday. We come against and rebuke every Judas spirit in the name of Jesus, Father. We just thank you for the power of the blood of Yeshua, Father. And whatever the kingdom of darkness is planning or plotting, we say return to center. Come on, say that. Return to center. In the name of Jesus. For no weapon formed against us shall prosper, and every tongue that rise up against us shall be condemned. We thank you for the power of the blood. We thank you for the name of Jesus and the power of his word. In Jesus' name, amen. So let it be.
Okay, so who are my two readers? Come up here and... we're going to start with Esther chapter 2, and we're going to read 5 through 8, and then we're going to start reading in Esther chapter 3. So, okay, Cinderella, turn it off. Who gave it to her? Grandma, tell her how to turn it off. Esther 2. Yeah, Esther 2, starting in verse 5. We're going to read 8, and then we're going to 5 through 8, and then we're going to start right there, Esther chapter 3. Okay. I'll start it off. And then, Dick, you pick it up, Esther chapter 3. Okay?
I'm gonna
No, Esther chapter 3, 1. Yeah, we'll start right from the beginning. But I'm going to read the Esther 2 through 5 through 8 so that we could kind of get give us the two out of the three characters right off the top, right? So now in Shushan, the palace, there was a certain Jew whose name was Mordecai. Yeah, thank you. Help us out. Remember, Mordecai is a yay, thumbs up, right? Yay! The son of Jair, the son of Shimshi, the son of Kish, a Benjamite, who had been carried away from Jerusalem with the captivity which had been carried away with the Conan king of Judah, whom Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had carried away. And when he brought up Hadashah, that is Esther, his uncle's daughter, for she had never father nor mother, and the maid was fair and beautiful, whom Mordecai, when her father and mother were dead, took from him his own daughter. So it came to pass, when the king's commandment and his decree was heard, and when many maidens were gathered together unto Shushan the palace, to the custody of Haggai, that Esther was brought also unto the king's house to the custody of Haggai, keeper of the women. Esther chapter 3.
After these things, did King Ahasuerus promote Haman, the son of Hammedatha the Agagite, and advance him and set his seat above all the princes that were with him. And all the king's servants that were in the king's gate bowed and reverenced Haman. For the king had so commanded concerning him, but Mordecai bowed not, nor did him reverence. Then the king's servants which were in the king's gate said unto Mordecai, why transgressed thou the king's commandment? Now it came to pass, when they spake daily unto him, and he hearkened not unto them, that they told Haman to see whether Mordecai's matters would stand, for he had told them that he was a Jew. And when Haman saw that Mordecai bowed not, nor did him reverence, then was Haman full of wrath. And he thought scorn to lay hands on Mordecai alone, for they had showed him the people of Mordecai. Wherefore Haman sought to destroy all the Jews that were throughout the whole kingdom of Ahasuerus, even the people of Mordecai. In the first month, that is, the month Nisan, in the 12th year of King Ahasuerus, they cast Pur, that is the lot, before Haman. They cast Pur from day to day and from month to month to the 12th month, that is the month Adar. And Haman said unto King Ahasuerus, there is a certain people scattered abroad and dispersed among the people in all the provinces of thy kingdom, and their laws are diverse from all people. Neither keep they the king's laws, therefore it is not for the king's profit to suffer them. If it please the king, Let it be written that they may be destroyed, and I will pay 10,000 talents of silver to the hands of those that have the charge of the business to bring it into the king's treasuries. And the king took the ring from his hand and gave it unto Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, the Jews' enemy. And the king said unto Haman, the silver is given to thee, the people also, to do with them as it seemeth good to thee. Then were the king's scribes called on the 13th day of the first month, and these was written according to all that Haman had commanded unto the king's lieutenants, and to the governors that were over every province, and to the rulers of every people of every province, according to the writing thereof, and to every people after their language. In the name of King Ahasuerus was it written and sealed with the king's ring, and the letters were sent by post into all the king's provinces to destroy, to kill, and to cause to perish all Jews, both young and old, little children and women, in one day, even upon the 13th day of the 12th month, which is the month Adar, and to take the spoil of them for prey. The copy of the writing for a commandment to be given in every province was published unto all people, that they should be ready against that day. The post went out, being hastened by the king's commandment, and the decree was given in Shushan, that the palace. And the king and Haman sat down to drink, but the city Shushan was perplexed.
Stop right there for a minute. Yeah, amen. You're going to pick it up in chapter 4, but I want you to, I'm setting the, you guys know the setting now, right? If you've seen One Night with the King, you understand that this now has been turned where the king was tricked into setting a decree that all the Jews would be killed, right? So this is where we are. So that's why Haman, What happened was Haman, He was a descendant of a tribe that should have been killed long time ago. This is a good teaching. Let a demon hang around long enough, he will attack you. He'll always try and come back. And look how bad he tried to come back. Amen? So we have to be careful when there's stuff that needs to be dead in your life, make sure they dead. Amen? Because you know what I'm talking about. That same dude will call you 8 years later, and you ain't kill it back then, here it come. So now we're going to start with Esther 4. So as Brother Dale's reading, y'all have the same enthusiasm. I know it's hard to stay enthusiastic every time, but please have the same enthusiasm as we go forward. We're not going to read the whole book, thank God. We're just going to read some.
With Mordecai.
Yay! Turn the yellow mic up, please.
Proceed all that was done. Mordecai.
Yay!
Rent his clothes and put on sackcloth with ashes and went out into the midst of the city and cried with a loud and bitter cry and came even before the king's gate, for none might enter into the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. And in every province, whithersoever the king commanded and his decree came, there was a great mourning among the Jews, and fasting and weeping and wailing, and many laid in sackcloth and ashes. So Esther's maids and her chamberlains came and told it to her. Then was the queen exceedingly grieved, and she sent raiment, a remnant of clothes, in Mordecai.
Yay!
And to take away the sackcloth from him, but he received it not. Then called Esther for a hot touch, one of the king's chamberlains, whom he had appointed to attend upon her, and gave him a commandment to Mordecai. Yay! To know what it was and why it was. So Hattop went forth to Mordecai,
Yay!
Unto the streets of the city which was before the king's gate. And Mordecai told him all that had happened to him, and of the sum of the money that Haman had promised to pay to the king's treasuries for the Jews who destroyed them. Also, he gave him the copy of the writing of the decree that was given to Sheshan to destroy them, to show it unto Esther. And to declare it unto her, and to charge her that she should go into unto the king to make supplication unto him, and to make requests before him for her people. And Hattach came and told Esther the words of Mordecai. Again, Esther spake unto Hattach and gave him commandments unto Mordecai. All the king's servants and the people of the king's province do know that whatsoever whether man or woman shall come unto the king into the inner court who is not called, there is one law of his to put him to death, except such of whom the king shall hold out the golden scepter that he may live. But I have not been called to call in unto the kings these 30 days. And they told to Mordecai Esther's words. Then Mordecai commanded to answer Esther, think not that thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house more than all the Jews. For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall thy enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed, and who knoweth whether thou art come to the king's kingdom for such a time as this? Then Esther bade them return Mordecai this answer. Go gather together all the Jews that are present in Shechem, and fast ye for me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days and night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, and so will I go unto the king, which is not according to the law, and if I perish, I perish. So Mordecai went his way and did according to all that Esther had commanded him.
Glory, hallelujah. So this is chapter 4 is one of the most highlighted verses that's here. It's verse 16. And it's, Esther says, when it says, go gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan and fast ye for me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days, night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, so will I go to the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish. And this is where we get the 3-day fast, which is the fast for life and death. When we have life and death situations that are transpiring, this is one of the fasts that we can do. Amen. And we can see there that because Esther, remember, she was a young teenage girl. She was only like 14 or 15 years of age. And notice she says, and that's the reason why when we do corporate fasting, amen, there comes a time where we have to come together even as a body believer. I believe it was, I think we only had two presidents in the history of America that called the nation to a fast. I think it was Andrew Jackson and Abraham Lincoln. And I said, what would happen if we will have presidents of this day that would do that? Yes. Amen? And so here it is, we can see that here that she says, if I perish, I perish. Because sometimes we have to understand that it's just not just about you. In this selfish world that we're in, we just think it's about us, amen? For instance, if you're living on a block and you might have the nicest house on the block, but it doesn't do any good for you to have a nice house on the block and all the rest of the houses are condemned or what have you. So we have to be people we can learn through this story is that God, and he says this, that he wished that no man should perish. That is the reason why we go the extra mile. because we want at every opportunity to give individuals an opportunity to know the God that we serve, regardless of what their background come from, regardless of what they may have been involved in. There should be someone that's willing to go the extra mile. Amen. It may cost you something. You may have to turn your plate down. You may have to lose some sleep. Amen. But that is what it means to how we do things in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Because we have an example that when Jesus Christ died, we learned that in the preparation that we're in right now, he didn't do that just for him. He did that, and it says that he went to the cross willingly for you and for me, for those who hated him, for those who did not even know him, for those who would mistreat him, for those that were even, some of you probably sitting there saying, you mean to tell me that he still loved the ones that put the thorns, a crown on his head? He still loved the ones for the ones that pierced him in the side. And Hebrew tradition says that the man that pierced him on the side had an issue in one of his eyes, and that some of the blood popped out. And he became healed, and he was one of the forerunners to be able, and he was the one that says, we have killed the Son of God. Amen. We got to understand that sometimes when you're walking this walk, people are going to try to kill you. But to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. If you have made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, they cannot kill you. You will live forever and ever and ever. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. You're going to receive a new body. I remember as a little girl, I used to say, a little nursery rhyme would say, sticks and stones, what did it say? Sticks and stones may break my bones, but they say, well, words will never hurt me. Amen. And now that we know, when we look at the word of God, we come to find out, amen, that words will hurt you. Hallelujah. And that's the reason why the power of words are so important. So here it is, and we're coming up on Esther's, and it's called Esther's Intervention. And son, right after this, we're going to look at the little video clip that I have. It's actually a worship song. It comes from a part of the movie. Amen. And it says, now it came to pass on the third day. Say the third day. Third. Who got up on the third day? Yeah. Who got up on the third day? Yeah. So if you ever get down, you should at least get up by what? The third day. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. And whatever it looks like, at least give God, say, 3 days. Hallelujah. God say the third day. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. That Esther put on her royal apparel, stood in the inner court of the king's house, over against the king's house, and the king sat upon his royal throne in the royal house, over against the gates of the house. And it was so that when the king saw Esther, the queen, y'all forgot, y'all ain't root, y'all done got into my preaching, y'all supposed to... See, y'all done got it to the preacher. Amen. Glory be to God. Wait, I done lost my spot here. Where was that? Verse 3, where was that? Then said the king unto her, what will thy queen Esther? And what is thy request? It shall be even given thee to the half of the kingdom. I just get excited right there. When God led me to do the Esther fast years ago, and I would continue to do them, this I felt that was a personal message, that when you would take time out to spend with God, God is saying, what is it that you will have me to do for you? You done took 3 days out to get my attention, and now that I'm here, what is it you will have me to do for you? Hallelujah. And then in verse 4 says, and Esther answered, if it seems good unto the king, let the king and Haman come this day unto the banquet that I have prepared for you. You got to understand that sometimes you got to bring your enemy with you to the table. Or Psalms 23 would not make any sense. So that he prepare a table. See, nothing in the Bible goes without. He prepared a table in the presence of your enemy. There we go, right there, Psalms 23. He prepared a table in the presence of the enemy. And then verse 5, then the king said, cause Haman to make haste that he may do as Esther has said, so that the king and Haman came to the banquet that Esther had prepared. And the king said unto Esther at the banquet of wine, what is thy petition? Here it is again. When we're reading this story of prophetic eye, it's King Jesus, amen, or God, amen. He said, once again, he says, what is thy petition? We know petition represents our prayer. God is saying to him, what is your petition? What is your prayer? And notice what Esther, and he says, and it shall be granted thee, and what is thy request? He just kept coming back. What's your petition with request? What he's trying to get it. What is that you're needing? Half of the kingdom it shall be performed. Then answered Esther and said, my petition and my request, God is a God of both and, amen. If I have found favor, hallelujah, in the sight of the king, and if it please the king to grant my petition and to perform my request, let the king and Haman come to the banquet that I shall prepare for them, and I will do tomorrow as the king hath said. Here's what we learn right here is that in the process of getting your prayers answered, there's sometimes a waiting period. And see, here it is that we can learn. Esther wasn't rushing the process. Now, that would have been, I just know me. I had a situation today that I needed Pastor Adam, and he was shaving. I was just, I'm looking, and I was waiting for him to shave. And I'm like, how long is it going to take for you to finish shaving? I say, because my little engine is roaring, and I need you to be a part of this process right now. And I knew I could, in the middle of that process, I was praying a little bit, but I was probably doing some Russian tongue. Because I wanted to tell him this situation. But here it is. It's so fitting that we learn from Esther. Esther was like, what does that look like when Esther says, come to the banquet? That's an opportunity when we look at it and bring it into the now, is that we can look at that we come and still commune with God some more. You come back and worship with him some more. You can come back and read the word of God a little bit more. In the process of while you're waiting, in the process of making sure you're hearing from God, amen. In a situation, sometimes I'm fast. Many times we're fast for God, and I had to do that this week. I needed direction from God. Sometimes we forget about because we want God just to fix something. I didn't need a answer as a complete because I knew the situation I'm dealing with. It wasn't going to be like a nail and that's done with. I needed to fast because I wanted direction as to what action that I needed to take. How about doing those type of fastings so you can get the direction for God on that situation? You're not trying to twist God's arm and say, I need this to be done right now. And even though the situation, I could have pulled a Esther fast, but God did not tell me to do that in that situation. Amen? Hallelujah. So we always got to be mindful to still be able to move when God says move. Amen? And then it says, and then went Haman forth that day joyful and with a glad heart. You know, people, when they do a wickedness, they joyful and got a glad heart. And they are all, they just as, what we say, you just as wrong and strong as you want to be. Amen. And he stood not up nor moved for him. He was full of indignation against Mordecai. Nevertheless, Haman refrained himself. And when he came home, he sent and called for his friends and Zeresh his wife. And Haman told them of the glory of his riches and of the multitude of his children and of all the things wherein the king had promoted him, and how he had advanced him above the princes and servants of the king. Look at that pride. Haman, so moreover ye Esther the queen did let no man come in with the king until the banquet that she had prepared. But myself and tomorrow have I invited unto her also with the king. Yet all this availed me nothing, so long as I see Mordecai the Jew sitting at the king's gate. Then said Zara, some people, you know, you got to understand, they don't like you. They just look at you. They made their mind up they don't like you. I've had people that have done that. Amen. They just look at you and say, oh, we don't like you. Hallelujah. And I just say, I don't need you to like me because God loves me. Hallelujah. Get over yourself. Glory be to God. In verse 14, then said Zara, his wife, and all his friends unto him, let a gallows be made with 50 cubits high, and tomorrow speak thou unto the king that Mordecai may be hanged thereon. Then go thou to merrily with the king unto the banquet, and the king pleased Haman, and he caused the gallows to be made. We're going to pick up at verse 6. But I want to say this here. Be careful about the plot. And what we're learning here, or what are the dicks you trying to build for someone else? Because what my grandma would say, dig two, because one gonna be needed for you. Amen. What you reap, you sow. Amen. So, can we have the screen? We're ready to pull that up. And so, this is I want you to just say at this time, say, I'm born for this. If you're living right now, you're born for this. Regardless of what trial or tribulation you're in, you're born for it. God would not have you to still be living if he didn't think that you could overcome it. I'm going to say that again. God would not have you to still be living right now today if he did not think that you can overcome it. This is your destiny, and you're born for this. Hallelujah. Come on, look at your neighbor and say this. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're at chapter 7. Are we on chapter 6? Yeah, chapter 6. Okay, we'll get Deacon Dale do chapter 6, and then Pastor Adam, you will close us out with chapter 7. And I've seen some candy that was in my office. Is that for the little ones, Minister Margo? We're going to get them some candy tonight, we're going to get the little treats. We'll have that. Amen. Glory.
On that night, could not the king sleep, and he commanded to bring the book of records of the chronicles, and they were read before the king. And it was found written that Mordecai had told Bagathan and Teresh, two of the king's chamberlains, the keepers of the door who sought to lay hands on the king Ahasuerus. And the king said, what honor and dignity have been done to Mordecai for this? Then said the king's servant that ministered unto him, there is nothing done for him. And the king said, who is in the court? Now Haman was coming to the outward court of the king's house to speak unto the king to hang Mordecai on the gallows that he had prepared for him. And the king's servant said unto him, behold, Haman standeth in the court. And the king said, let him come in. So Haman came in, and the king said unto him, what shall be done unto the man whom the king delighted to honor? Now Haman thought in his heart, to whom would the king delight to do honor more than to him, to myself? And Haman answered the king, for the man whom the king delighted to honor, let the royal apparel be brought which the king uses to wear, and the horse that the king rideth upon, and the crown royal which is set upon his head, and let his apparel and the horse be delivered to the hand of the one of the king's most noble prince, that they may array the man withal whom the king delighted to honor, and bring him on horseback through the street of the city, and proclaim before him, thus shall it be done to the man whom the king delighted to honor. Then the king said to Haman, make haste and take the apparel and the horse as thou hast said, and do even so to Mordecai,
yay,
the Jew, and sit it at the king's gate. Let nothing fail of all thou hast spoken. Then Haman, then took Haman the apparel and the horse and arrayed Mordecai,
yay,
and brought him
winner.
And brought him on horseback through the streets of the city, and proclaimed before him, thus shall it be done unto the man whom the king delighted to honor. And Mordecai,
yay,
came again to the king's gate. But Haman, hasted to his house mourning and having his head covered. And Haman, told Zeresh, his wife, and all his friends, everything that had befallen him. Then said this wise man and Sarah's his wife unto him, if Mordecai,
yay,
be of the seed of the Jews before whom thou begun to fall, thou shalt not prevail against him, but shall surely fall before him. And while they were yet talking with him, came the king's chamberlains in haste to bring Haman,
boo,
unto the banquet that Esther had prepared.
Amen. You see that? First of all, what the enemy meant for bad, God used for his good. Amen? Amen. No, and it's also like in Psalms 23, God will make a table before you in the presence of your enemies. Amen? Deke, you pick up in chapter 7, we want to see the bad man die, and then we'll deal with, and then we'll finish with 10. So Deacon Harris, chapter 7, and then I'll go through 8 and 9. You got it.
So the king and Haman came to banquet with Esther the queen, and the king said,
go ahead.
And the king said again unto Esther,
yay!
On the second day at the banquet of wine, what is thy petition, Queen Esther?
Yay!
And it shall be granted thee, and what is thy request? And it shall be performed, even to the half of the kingdom. Then Esther the queen,
yay!
Answered and said, if I have found favor in thy sight, O king, and if it please the king, let my life be given me at my petition and my people at my request. For we are sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be slain, and to perish. But if we had been sold for bondmen and bondwomen, I had held my tongue, although the enemy could not countervail the king's damage. Then the king Ahasuerus answered and said unto Esther the queen,
yay!
Who is he, and where is he, that durst presume in his heart to do so? And Esther said,
yay!
The adversary and enemy is this wicked Haman.
Boom! Loser, loser, loser!
Then Haman was afraid before the king and the queen. And the king, arising from the banquet of wine in his wrath, went into the place, the palace garden, and Haman stood up to make request for his life to Esther, the queen. For he saw that there was evil determined against him by the king. Then the king returned out of the palace garden into the place of the banquet of wine, and Haman was fallen upon the bed whereon Esther was. Then said the king, will he force the queen also before me in the house? As the word went out of the king's mouth, they covered Haman's face. And Harbona, one of the chamberlains, said before the king, behold also the gallows 50 cubits high, which Haman had made for Mordecai,
yay,
who had spoken good for the king, standeth in the house of Haman. Then the king said, hang him thereon. So they hanged Haman.
But really, yay!
They hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai.
Yay!
Then was the king's wrath pacified.
Amen. Let's talk about this. This is a powerful text. You see what happens, right? Esther, Hadassah, opens up the story and tells the king exactly Haman's plan. Amen. And instead of all the stuff that Haman had prepared to do, what he thought was going to do to Mordecai or embarrass Mordecai or to kill Mordecai, always came back and bit Haman in the butt. So if you believe, and like I believe, that if you trust in God enough, the enemy's plan will always come to bite him in the butt, not the opposite plan. Amen. So it was fun to see good old poor Haman get what was coming to him. Amen? You don't like to see somebody die, but it was glad. I was glad that story happened. So now we don't hear about the loser too much longer in this. Yeah. But I'm going to quickly, I'm going to read a couple of verses on each in 8, 9, and 10 so that we can be done. Amen? So first 8:1, I'm gonna eat 8:1 to 8:5, and then I'm gonna read 9, and then I'm gonna read 10 is small. So 8:1 through 5. Amen. We're almost there. What time is it? Y'all might even get out early. On that day did the king Ahasuerus give the house of Haman, the Jews' enemy, unto Esther the king. Esther the queen, and Mordecai came before the king, for Esther had told what he was unto her. And the king took off his ring, which had given to Haman, and he gave it to Mordecai. There was a transfer of wealth and authority right there on the spot. Remember, if you're standing righteous for God, the transfer of authority, wealth, and power will come to you. This is Purim. This is what it is. It's about the living a sweet life. God's getting ready to turn things around. And gave it to Mordecai. And Esther set Mordecai over the house of Haman. He's even living in the devil's house, refreshed. I'm sure he prayed over it. He probably rent his clothes a little bit more before he got in there, but he did. Verse 3. And Esther. Y'all losing. I'm losing. You only got a little bit left. Got a little more gas left in the tank there. And Esther spake yet again to before the king and fell down at his feet and besought him with tears to put away the mischief of Haman, the Agagite, and his device that he devised against the Jews. Then the king held out the golden scepter towards Esther. So Esther arose and stood before the king and said, if it please the king, and if I found favor in his sight, and the thing seems right before the king, and I be pleasing in his eyes, let it be written to reverse the letter devised by Haman, the son of the Hammedatha, the Agagite, which he wrote to destroy the Jews, which are in all the king's province. For how can I endure to see the evil that shall come unto my people, or how can I endure to see the destruction of my kindred? Then the king Ahasuerus said unto Esther, the queen, and to Mordecai, the Jew, behold, I have given Esther the house of Haman. Come on, hang in there. And him that have hanged unto the gallows because he had laid his hands upon the Jews. Write ye also for the Jews that is liketh you in the king's name and seal it with the king's ring, for the writing which is written in the king's name and seal with the king's ring may no man reverse. What he's saying is he wrote this down. You can't reverse what has already been decreed. That's why you got to be careful what you put out your mouth, because once it's been decreed, it's very hard to get it reversed. Y'all gonna get quiet. I mean, I appreciate that. So what I try to decree out of my mouth is only the things of God that I expect for me. Amen? Because a decree is a decree. And I'm walking in my kingship. What I say is power. What y'all say is power. Then were the king's scribe called, verse 9, at the time in the third month, that is the month of Sivan, on the 23rd day thereof, and it was written according to all that Mordecai commanded unto the Jews, and to the lieutenants, and to the deputies, and the rulers of the provinces, which are from India unto Ethiopia, and 127 provinces unto every province, according to the writing thereof, and unto every people after their language, and to the Jews according to their writing, and according to their language. And he wrote in the king Ahasuerus' name, and sealed it with the king's ring, and sent letter back, postal horseback, and riders on mules, camels, and young dromedaries. Wherein the king granted the Jews which were in every city to gather themselves together and to stand for their life, to destroy, to slay, to cause, to perish all the powers of the people of provinces that would assault them, both little ones and women, to take the spoil of them for a prey. What? He didn't undo the decree, but what he did was make a new decree. Said, if anybody come to attack them, you have the right to protect yourself and take your stuff back. If the enemy come try to take you, you have the right to defend yourself, defend your stuff, cause them to perish, and get your stuff back. Y'all need to stand on that decree right by itself. Say, you know what? The enemy done stole some stuff from me. He done attacked my family. He done attacked my children. I'm getting ready to take my stuff back. I'm getting ready to defeat him because God has written a decree on my behalf. This is Purim, and I promise to get my stuff back. I'm going to get my dignity back. I'm going to get my health back. I'm going to get my children back. I'm getting whatever was taken from me, I'm getting it all back. Whew. Chapter 9. No, I'm just going to read you. Okay. It's, now in the 12th month, that is the month of Adar, on the 13th day of the same, when the king's commandment of his decree drew near to be put in execution in the day that the enemies of the Jews hoped to have power over them, though it was turned to the contrary, that the Jews had rule over them that hated them, the Jews gathered themselves together in the cities throughout all the provinces of the king Ahasuerus to lay on such as sought their hurt, and no man could withstand them for the fear of them that fell upon all the people. And the rulers of the provinces and the lieutenants and the deputies and the officers of the king helped the Jews because they fear the fear of Mordecai fell upon them. For Mordecai was great in the king's house, and his fame went out throughout all the provinces. For this man Mordecai waxed greater and greater. Thus the Jews smote all the enemies with the stroke of the sword and slaughter and destruction, and did what they would unto those that hated them. And in Shushan, the place the Jews slew and destroyed 500 men. And then all these other places they destroyed. Amen. And they won. Say they won. So in verse 10, chapter 10, this is only three verses. We're going to close out in this. And the king Ahasuerus laid a tribute on the land and upon the isles of the sea. Well, let's go back to 9 and 31. 9 and 31, you got it? 9, 31, 32. 9, 31 says, to confirm these days of Purim in their times appointed according as Mordecai, the Jews, and Esther the queen had enjoined them. And they have decreed for themselves, for their seed, the matter of the fasting and their crying. And the decree of Esther confirmed these matters of Purim, and it was written in the book. Purim was supposed to be celebrated from that point on. Amen? Because it celebrates the time when they had cast lots, and God took them through victory. And the king Ahasuerus laid a tribute upon the land, and upon the isles of the sea, and all the acts of his power and his might, and declaration of the greatness of Mordecai, whereunto the king advanced him, as they were not written in the book of the chronicles of the king of Media and of Persia. For Mordecai the Jew was next unto King Ahasuerus, and the great among the Jews, and accepted the multitude of his brethren, seeking the wealth of his people, and speaking peace to all his seed. I would speak that right now in Jesus' name, Yeshua HaMashiach's name. I speak peace to all my seed. I speak peace to my seed and their seed. This was so powerful because Mordecai is actually written in the book of the kings of Persia and the kings of Media. Mordecai, a Jew, in a Muslim book. Oh, y'all got quiet, yes. Mordecai, the Jew, is written in the books of Persia.